right, welcome to the Switch4Good podcast. Dotsy and Alexandra here, and we have a really special guest. But before we reveal who that is, I just can't help but pause for a moment and let everyone know that Alexandra was a minister this weekend at her sister's wedding, and I want to hear all about it.
Yeah, I know. I married my sister, who married me when Ian and I got married 18 years ago. So she married her longtime love, Wendy, and it was a very small wedding in San Francisco area. And the great thing is that the food was vegan. Because my sister's vegan, she's my identical twin, and my sister's vegan, and my brother's vegan, and I'm vegan, but she's in a mixed marriage now, like I am, because Ian, my husband, is not vegan, and Wendy, her partner, or now her wife, right. Sorry, I'm not so, for 10 years they were partners. So it was,
long courtship.
So yeah, she eats animal foods. So
well, how did Wendy feel about the all vegan wedding then? She was pretty chill.
She was totally chill. She Good. Was great. So open. That's what's great about both Ian and Wendy is ever. And Wendy's the cook in the family, so she cooks a lot of great things.
So does she cook two meals for them then?
Does she cook
like she cooks a meat meal for herself and then a vegan meal for your sister?
I think that happens sometimes. Yeah. Okay. Or she eats a lot of vegan stuff too. She just doesn't.
Because hopefully everyone is, as Michael has pointed out before, hopefully everyone is eating a lot of vegan foods because hopefully you're eating vegetables and fruits and legumes
Very
and nuts.
Very important
and...
to be healthy. Yes, you can't just be non-vegan.
Right.
So,
right.
Yeah, but it was really fun. And just and the wedding cake was vegan too, and it was delicious.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, see, you can bake vegan too.
Yes, and actually our guest this week is going to talk to us more about all the yummy things that we can cook vegan, because she is a nutritionist and has two books out and that give us a lot of great recipes. On
so excited.
Yeah. So I want to introduce Tracye Lynn McQuirter. She is a 30-year vegan, a nutritionist, and she founded the Black Vegetarian Society of New York. She directed the nation's first federally funded vegan nutrition program, and Tracye has worked on legislation to improve federal nutrition guidelines. She also works to reverse childhood obesity and has served as a nutrition consultant for the Black Women's Health Imperative, the largest health advocacy organization for Black women and girls. Tracye is the author of the national bestseller, By Any Greens Necessary, a revolutionary guide for Black women who want to eat great, get healthy, lose weight, and look fat. And fat, by the way, is not spelled F-A-T. It's spelled P-H-A-T, which this white girl had to look up.
Oh, dear.
I mean, I knew what it meant, sort of, but I just want to make sure as a good host. It means looking great and sexy. Right, Tracye?
Yeah, curvy. Yeah.
Curvy. Oh, it's okay. All right.
We're exposing our inadequacies already.
And this year, she co-authored a book with her 82-year-old mother, Mary, called Ageless Vegan, The Secret to Living a Long Plant-Based Life. So from the Washington, D.C. area, let's welcome nutritionist, author, and vegan pioneer, Tracye McQuirter. Hi,
hey.
Tracye.
Hey, how are you? It's great to be here.
Thank you so much for being on our podcast. Dotsy and I really appreciate it. I want to ask you first about Dick Gregory. We're about the same age, and Dick Gregory actually was somebody that I used to see on television and hear about in the 70s, and you heard Dick Gregory speak and it changed your life. Will you tell us a little bit about who Dick Gregory was and why did he make such a big impact on you?
Right. Well, Dick Gregory, I like to say, is the reason that I'm vegan. So even though my mother planted the seed, you know, when we were growing up, we were healthy-ish eaters, I didn't like it. And so when I was a sophomore at Amherst College in Massachusetts in 1986, our Black Student Union brought Dick Gregory to campus to talk about the state of Black America, political, economic, social state. And instead, he talked about the plight of Black America and how unhealthily most folks eat. And so Dick Gregory was a comic genius. He was the pioneer. He was the first Black comic to cross over into white audiences talking about racial issues as a humorist. And then, he's making tons of money and then left that all behind to join the civil rights movement full time and be a right hand person to Medgar Evers and to Martin Luther King. And he paved the way for other comics to take his place. Some who are in jail now and shall remain nameless. So by the time we brought him to campus in 86, he had already been vegan for 20 years. And he became vegan because of the practice of nonviolence during the civil rights movement. He extended that from people to animals. But he was still, 300 pounds. He was a heavy smoker and drinker. He was not health conscious. And it was a woman named Dr. Alvenia Fulton, a naturopathic doctor, who opened the first vegan health food store and cafe on the south side of Chicago in the 1950s. She came to him in the 1960s and said, "Let me help you go on a fast. Let me help you clean up your diet and go vegan." And she is the one that started him on the healthy vegan path. So he went vegan for ethical animal rights reasons first, nonviolence, compassion reasons, and then health reasons about 10 years after that. So by the time he came to our campus, he had a whole Bahamian diet, drink, vegan empire going on that we knew nothing about. So he had this captive 5 college audience of college students and decided to flip the script and just talk about why we should be vegetarian. And at that time, vegetarian was the umbrella term for all the types of plant-based eaters there were, but he meant vegan. And so I had gained 25 pounds my freshman year because I was away from home for the first time and did not have to eat vegetables or fruit or any of the healthy stuff my mother made us eat when we were growing up. And I didn't want to hear anything about it, but I was kind of captive. And he traced the path of a hamburger from a cow on a factory farm through the slaughterhouse process to a fast food restaurant, to a clogged artery, to a heart attack. And that is the thing that really got to me and planted the seed and caused me to start looking into it myself. And that's how I started on the path.
So that you're in the college. Most college age kids are not super concerned about a heart attack, right? You feel like you're, kind of above dying any age under 20, right? Like, oh, that's so far away, I'm going to be fine. So what about that process you just described from the cow to the heart attack? What really got to you?
So this is what, 10 years before the internet. So he spoke for about 2.5 hours and it was very graphic, and I had never heard that process before. I had 2 vegetarian teachers in the 7th grade at Sidwell Friends School in DC, and they wanted our camping trip to be vegetarian. I wrote a petition against it. Like, I was opposed to healthy food. But I never asked them why they were vegetarian. And so he was explaining the process, right? And I ate hamburgers every day. Hamburgers, cheeseburgers, hot dogs, french fries, every single day, pizza. So he was talking to me. And I had gained 25 pounds in a year. So, I was still small, but, I was on the trajectory that he was talking about. And also, what's really crucial, too, is that he connected it to why the food industry provides this unhealthy food for us. He talked about lobbying. He talked about subsidies. He talked about food justice, food desert. In 1986, he made all of these connections. And I was going through a paradigm shift at the time. I had taken the relaxer out of my hair. I was taking all of these classes on racism and sexism and imperialism and homophobia and all of these things that I was learning about for the first time or in new, deeper ways. And so my whole paradigm was shifting. And so I was ready to hear this message. So it was all of that for me.
Dick Gregory is an amazing, amazing person. I'm so glad that part of your history includes him so that we can, our listeners can maybe look him up and learn more about him now that he's sadly gone, but he exists still on the internet. He's written an amazing book that I read, probably more than one, right? But I know
absolutely.
Yeah.
And but in fact, there's a play about his life called Turn Me Loose that Joe Morton from Scandal starred in. It's now in DC. I just went to see it this weekend. And I was told by the star of it, Edwin Lee Gibson, that it's going to Broadway. So people will have an opportunity to hear
about him. Oh, great. Yeah. So you talked a little bit about your childhood before college and that your mom was very into healthy food. My mom also was into healthy food. In fact, I think that was really good as a whole in terms of a foundation, but I did rebel and because I couldn't wait to eat Cap'n Crunch when I went away, right? And so I overdid it, and actually it led me into I'm not gonna blame my mom for my eating disorder, but because this was so restricted, I think that was a trigger for me to binge a little on food.
Want everything else, right?
Yeah,
other kids were eating.
What was your...
Well, I mean, no, my mom was desiring and trying and wanting to feed us a healthful diet. But no, I grew up in Kentucky and we existed on iceberg lettuce and ranch dressing and hot dogs and macaroni and cheese and corn on the cob. That wasn't too bad. In the 70s, thinking that was pretty balanced, and we had most of what we needed, and different meats too thrown in there, but there wasn't a severe restriction. The only thing that she really didn't allow was sugar cereals, which is why that's funny that you were dying for Captain Crunch. I was dying for Fruit Loops, but we got them once a year when we went on vacation to Florida, and my sister and I would get the variety pack because you don't want to just get one, and then we'd fight the entire vacation on what was I don't know if that would serve the purpose. My mom was like, oh my gosh.
Tracye, can you relate to any of this?
Absolutely. We did not have sugary cereals either. We didn't even have soda. No sugar bowl, no cookie jar, none of it. I mean, we were omnivores, but no sugary cereals, no junk, no candy, none of that. But I had cousins who had that food. And so when we went to visit them, oh my God, we could just gorge on sodas, on Captain Crunch, on Apple Jacks, on Fruit Loops, all of it. And I loved it. And so, I had a taste of what else was out there. But my mother was that way with us. We had total cereal, we had skim milk, we had whole wheat bread, because she, when she was pregnant with my oldest sister, who's 5 years older than me, so in 1961, she decided that she wanted to raise healthy children. And so she read Dr. Spock and others just to find out, what's healthiest to eat. And he was promoting a meat and dairy-based diet then, although he later began promoting a vegan diet. So it was health conscious as an omnivore, right? But she was also addicted to sugar. And went to OA to deal with that. It was a real struggle for about 10 years in her life. And so that's the reason that we didn't have sodas or sugary cereals or cookie jar desserts on a regular basis, because she was grappling with that and she didn't want it in the house and she didn't want to introduce it to us.
Yeah. I too struggle with sugar and went to OA too, and it helped me immensely. So, I'm looking forward to talking to your mom one day too.
Yes.
So your books, though, you've started the Black Vegetarian Society of New York, as I said in your introduction, and your books are aimed to Black women. Tell me why you chose to aim them to Black women.
Well, the first book I wrote in 2000, came out in 2010, wrote in 2009, and there weren't any books targeting Black women that were vegan. Most of the vegan diet books out were targeting white women. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to write the book that I wanted to read, that I would have wanted when I first became vegan. And Toni Morrison said, if that book doesn't exist, then you have to write it. So that's the book I wrote. My sister and I had started a website called blackvegetarians.com in 1997, and that was one of the first vegan websites ever. And so we had thousands of subscribers, and so I knew that there was a hungry audience for that. We did that website until about 2005. So, you know, we were known, there was this community that existed. There were other Black vegetarian societies in different large cities around the country. But there was no book for us, you know, Black women or men in particular. And I wanted to target us. And also, although we are fabulous, we happen to have the worst health outcomes in the country, Black women, for a variety of reasons. And so I wanted to talk specifically to that audience, to my folks, and let them know, you know, why that's so and how we can change it. And so it was needed, and it resonated. And also Sister Vegan by Dr. Breeze Hopper came out that same year, about a couple of months before mine. And that was a collection of essays by Black women vegans. And so there are different types of books, but both of those books came out at the same time. And so, you know, I think we're both proud that we were very influential in helping to grow the movement. We just filled the need that we wanted personally and that we knew that other people wanted.
Sorry, go ahead.
Well, I want everyone to know, I'll speak for myself. I would like to know, what are the top, let's say, three differences between books that were already out that were targeting white women and vegetarianism and veganism and the book that you wrote for the Black community?
Right.
I don't know. I mean, to me, like, food is food.
Right.
So, this is fascinating.
All books are written for, most books are written for us, so we
which is stupid. I recognize that it's, right. Yeah. So, like, I want to educate people and me.
Yeah, I'd like to know, too.
Well, first of all, there was this culture of thinness, right? This this white woman body ideal that was being promoted for veganism for women. And that, you know, and that's very culturally specific for white women. It does not necessarily apply to Black women. Our bodies are shaped differently. We have different cultural views about curviness, about thickness. And so, you know, that message does not necessarily resonate as a reason for people to go vegan. And just because you're thin doesn't mean you're healthy, right? So I was focused on health. And Black women have the worst health outcomes in the country. And so that's the second reason. Like, we needed a book that talked specifically about that and how eating plant-based foods can help turn that around. And there was no book that was specifically talking about that. And then culturally, we're vegan pioneers. I mean, there's Dick Gregory, there's Alvinia Fulton who helped him, but there, you know, it goes back centuries. Even to West Africa, where most of us were enslaved and brought from, we were primarily plant-based there, not plant-exclusive, but plant-based. And so I wanted to talk about the cultural tie, the connection, and to say that, you know, there's always been this stream of Black folks who've been vegan pioneers next to this mighty river of Black folks who are omnivores, right? And so those are three reasons, you know, just off the top, that there needed to be a book that talked to Black women.
That is illuminating for me. And as you're saying all of them, I'm like, oh, of course, right, you know, but it's not something, which is why you wrote the book, that anyone had really talked about before or maybe even thought of. And you've produced starter guides that over 500,000 copies have been handed out specifically targeting African-American communities. I want to see one. I couldn't find one on the internet, so I think I need one to, you probably have one right there. There we go. Well, so we got to tell people, I want to tell people we can get those, but what am I going to find in there? Can I find something in there that would be helpful to me too?
Oh, of course. Okay. I mean, it talks about veganism. That's the bottom line. How and why to transition, right? And the different questions that people ask when they've decided to do it and they don't know what to do next. So you'll find information. You'll find a glossary of common terms. You'll find where to get your protein, top 10 sources, how to eat out healthfully, how to get your B12, your iron, your calcium, vitamin D. You'll find recipes. There are 11 other vegan experts two lifelong vegans, one Olympian, some chefs, a historian, a vegan pediatrician. You know, so there are other perspectives there, multiple vegan perspectives. So there is that, you know, common information about how and why to go vegan. You'll find information about the environment, about animal advocacy. So one of the differences with this guide and other guides that target whites primarily, or any other, you know, cultural group, we all have a cultural milieu that we were born in and a lens that we see from. And I think it's important to meet folks where they are and to write about veganism from those perspectives. And so this guide is actually being used as a model for creating a guide for Latinx communities, for Asian communities, for African communities here and abroad. So there's a need for many types of guides, right? But this one also has two pages of history. There's a timeline for Black vegan pioneers in here. There is information about what to do at family reunions when you're not eating the mac and cheese and the fried chicken and the collard greens with the meat in it. There's information about specifically how many Black vegans and vegetarians there are and why we benefit the most in terms of health when we go vegan. There's an interview with Milton Mills that talks about the West African diets, you know, as I said, and, you know, why we need to go back to that type of food and how we strayed. It was forced upon us during enslavement and how that then became soul food, then industrialized to where we are today. There's information from Brian Terry talking about the roots that we have in eating greens from the South, from growing our own fruits and vegetables, and how we need to get back to that. So there's a lot of culturally specific information.
We've had actually Dr. Mills on the show, and we talked a lot about food and racism and culture. So to go back to that, what you mentioned about women and Blacks as a group having benefiting more from going vegan, can you tell us a bit about why that is so?
Because we, when we die earliest of breast cancer, when we get diagnosed later. We have more aggressive forms and we die younger from it. When it comes to heart disease, we have higher rates. When it comes to diabetes, we have higher rates. When it comes to obesity and unhealthy weight, we have higher rates. Stroke the same way. So all of the same situation. So all of these chronic diseases, the top reasons that Americans die, they're exacerbated in African-American communities and particularly for Black women. And there are a variety of reasons for that. I mean, we're the most oppressed, impoverished, you know, as a community, as a whole. And so this system, this society, for the affluent, they get the healthiest food, the best schools. You know, across the board, things are better and set up for the affluent. The poorer you are, the more oppressed you are, the less you have of these resources, and food is a part of that. So, I mean, it's, you know, this is the way the system is set up. And so, and then there's also, which is very important that a lot of people don't talk about, but I talk about, the oxidizing of the cells that can lead to chronic disease is also a result of stress from chronic racism, right? From dealing with racism every day. It oxidizes our cells. And so that's why I always say there are a variety of reasons, because stress will kill you too, right? Stress can constrict your arteries, can cause you to have a heart attack as well, the top reason that people die. And racism is this system of white supremacy that we live under is a fact of life for everybody, for whites and Blacks and Asians, Native Americans, Latinx, all of us. We experience it the worst, and especially when it comes to our health. It also determines whether grocery stores are gonna set up shop in our community, whether we have access to healthy food, whether we have to go across town to get that food. I mean, there's this whole system, right, that we're dealing with that has caused us to be in the conditions that we're in. And also just because this is a food that we were brought up with, right? Mm-hmm. This is a food we were taught to eat, and a lot of people don't want to give that up because it tastes good, because they have cultural connections, because their parents gave it to them and their parents wouldn't give them unhealthy food. Their grandmother ate fried chicken and collard greens and unhealthy foods until she was 90 or 100. And so why can't they? I mean, there are lots of reasons, right? But the bottom line is we have the worst health outcomes. And so when we go plant-based, we gain the most in terms
and
of
lactose,
health.
Also lactose intolerance is something that occurs in a lot of culture, a lot of ethnic
people
groups.
People of color in general.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, around the world, across the board. And that's exactly right. And I know Milton and I worked at PCRM around the same time when he did that study with Neil Barnard. About racism in the U.S. dietary guidelines and food industry bias. But the bottom line is it's lactase persistence. You know, people of color primarily in this country and around the world lose that enzyme to digest mother's milk by the time we are weaned, usually three, four, or five. And so when you lose that enzyme, you can no longer break down the sugars in milk, in your mother's milk, but that also applies to other animals' milk as well. And so that's what is called lactose intolerance, but it's actually quite normal. Why are we consuming nursing secretions after we're weaned from any animal?
Because we're biogenetically set up to do that, right? Like that's
exactly. It's normal. And so, this idea that the USDA is telling us, even with that, despite that we should still drink milk and eat dairy products every day to be healthy, is ridiculous. It's insidious. And the result is that you have ads targeting people of color to eat dairy products. You have the dairy industry partnering with Black health organizations to try to get constituents to eat dairy products. Because they know that naturally when we consume it, the majority of us have a difficult time digesting it. And so, you know, it's being forced on us to, you know, this message that you still must eat it somehow. So you have lactate, you take pills, you deal with it.
So the U.S. Department of Agriculture is the one who tells us that we really should be consuming a variety of dairy products.
Right.
And we know Asian Americans are the highest intolerance, right? They're about 97-98%. African Americans are 87%. That's what I've seen. Is it about right about that?
About right, yeah.
Yeah. And they've known these numbers for 100 years. Dr. Mills said, about 100 years that information has been out. So they know that they are pushing their product on people who cannot tolerate it and cannot digest it. And hence it's making them very, very sick.
Yep, that's exactly right. I mean, and it's the food industry. It's all about profits, not the health of people. And then the medical industry benefits as well.
So that's, I just have to, if I can dive in, there's a, you know, a small amount or maybe a large amount of people that are kind of listening to this and their brains are starting to go, OMG, I hope. Just generically, what is food racism? We need like an explanation of it or a definition, you know, because
what is food racism? Well, it's usually called, I guess, food justice or food injustice. That's, but I mean, they're the same thing, but it's what I've been talking about. Like the reason, that's an example of it. The USDA pushing dairy products on people of color, right? And mandating that it gets served in schools unless you have a doctor's note. That's an example of racism in the dietary guidelines. And then the fact that in most communities of color that have not been gentrified, it's very difficult to find healthy food, but it's very eat healthy grocery stores, farmers markets. They exist, but not in the same way that they do in communities that are white and more affluent. Not, you know, in poor white communities, you have the same or similar issues. So it's, stores won't locate, grocery stores won't locate in predominantly Black communities of color that are also low income, but even in affluent Black neighborhoods. You have a similar issue. They won't locate there. Why not? So you have an issue where even if people are informed about how and why to eat healthier, they don't have access to it. So again, I know you wanted a sentence, but it's hard. These things are so interconnected.
Oh, that was beautiful.
That, you know, it's just how the systems work in the country. Education, politics, food, health, socially, all of these things are, you know, are the same system. Yeah. You know, it benefits the affluent and the white.
No, that was well said. And Dotsie's heard me complain about this, but when peanuts hurt white kids, they got chucked out of the school right away. And
exactly.
Yet it's been 100 years and we still
still
have dairy that is pushed on kids in schools.
And you can be that allergic. When I've said that to white women mothers before, they're like, yeah, but peanuts can cause anaphylactic shock. Oh, so can dairy. Mm-hmm. There are definite cases of it. It can cause anything from just a mild rash or a little bit of a sneeze or a runny nose to death. There was a story that came out about a year ago, and a young boy died when his bully schoolmate stuffed cheese down the front
of
his shirt. Do you remember that?
That's I do.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, it's true. Mm-hmm.
We have our Michael here, who is our board engineer and the owner of the network studios where we are. And he is a open-minded meat and dairy eater. And since you're a nutritionist and you deal a lot with people who want to get healthier, but struggle with taking their first steps to be vegan, can you give some advice to Michael about how three things he might do that might help him? He's sort of on his way, but we want to get him there completely.
We're not pushy or anything.
Does Michael want to get there completely?
Michael.
Yes.
He's interested for sure.
He knows the health peril.
He
drinks a gallon. What do you drink? A gallon of milk a day?
Almost. I've actually rendered it down ever since we started talking. I'm 42 years old. I do, in fact, consume more than I think my fair share, would be. And, I've rendered it down tremendously since this start of the, us recording these episodes. And I've been on a path, I grew up on a farm in northern New York and had, chickens, rabbits, goats, steers, horses, and all that, stuff, just a little self-contained farm. And, I had to deal with it growing up and just the classical conditioning of what was available to us. And I grew up actually in a lot of brown and black neighborhoods as a child prior to being on this little farm. We were poor. And so we lived where poor people lived, and it tended to be brown and black neighborhoods. And so I am very aware and very disappointed in the fact that, I'm living right next to Ladera here near Culver City. And Ladera is one of the most affluent black neighborhoods, but there's no Whole Foods close by. And they just built a neighborhood in a white area of Playa del Rey, and they drop kicked one of those stores the day they built the place. It's just amazing how we just don't care to do anything but liquor stores in brown and black neighborhoods.
Exactly. And fast food, greasy carryouts. Yeah.
It's terrible. Yeah. So what kind of advice would you give to Michael on how he can start? He says he's very busy. And although it does take the same amount of time to eat meat as it does to eat vegetables, but.
So here's what I would say in terms of adding, the easiest thing to do is to look at the foods that you're most likely to eat when you get home. Let's just start with the routine that you have now. What is it that you're doing? Are you making a stir fry? Are you having a salad and having some steak or having a piece of chicken? Like how are you using the animal protein? Is it by itself? Are you cutting it into pieces? Is it frozen and you're tossing it into a stir fry?
I'm not frozen. Okay. I'm not frozen. I'm taking meat. I buy meat that day before, put it in the fridge, cook it the next day. And I am definitely eating salads, definitely having broccoli, definitely having asparagus and things.
Excellent.
So my portion sizes have changed. I'm not having like a big T-bone. I'm just having, a skirt steak or, small little pieces. I've been leaning more into pork recently, I think it's just my cycle, my timing,
So I think that it's easy. It would be easy for you to swap out some plant-based proteins just talking about the way that you're eating now. So at night, you can pick up some of the plant-based proteins that are prepackaged. If you want, it's not the healthiest, but it's healthier and it's a place to start. So you can pick up the chicken or the ribs or the faux pork, you know, made out of jackfruit. You can pick up some beans, you know, some pre-cooked beans packed in water, and use beans instead. Beans, black beans, red beans, lentils. So you can also just use cashews in a stir fry. Instead of using meat, you can use walnuts, you can use almonds, you can use mushrooms. So there are lots of things for what you already do that you can swap out. And so that's where I would start. Just the notion that you need to have a big hunk of meat, it's not necessary to get your protein. You can use beans, you can use nuts, you can use tofu tempeh, and you can use some of these other prepackaged plant-based proteins from the store that are quick and already cooked, and you're just basically heating them up. So that you can do at night. You can have them on your salads and a stir fry, because it sounds like you're already eating great colorful vegetables, which is wonderful. So it's just swapping out the protein. And you can also get the vegan cheeses as well if you want, if you're using cheese. But in terms of time, that's a mental shift, right? You have to eat, and regardless of what you eat, that schedule is not serving you. So what I would suggest to start is to get up in the morning or at night to make a smoothie, right? If you put everything in the blender the night before, you can actually make the smoothie the night before, just put it in the fridge, blend it for a couple of seconds in the morning, put it in a portable container and take it with you and sip off of that. You can take a handful of nuts and raisins to eat. You can have a bar, but you must eat during the day. I mean, that has to shift. And even if you take an hour or two out of your day and just call up a vegan restaurant or a vegan friendly restaurant and have them deliver something to you don't even have to go. You know, start there, even if it's at Chipotle, you know, some place that you already know that as an example, that has vegan meals that are quick, just have them order it or just go pick it up around the corner. But you must start eating during the day. That's not
because our body stores. If it's not being fed, it will store. I mean, that's what happened to both of us during our eating disorders. Then we started healing coming out of them, and your body's, you know, conditioned in that, you know, just system of storing and storing, because that's what we go back to, right? Is we're all our bodies are trying to do is survive. That's their only goal and job every single day. But one thing for Michael too, Tracye, I always think about, you know, there we talked a lot about or a little bit at least, I would love to talk so much more about food injustice and something like a glass of milk, which we talk a lot about dairy on this show and building a dairy-free future, and something as simple as a glass of milk that people have been conditioned to believe is the best form of protein or calcium or even vitamin D, which there is no naturally occurring vitamin D in cow's milk, period. It's not naturally occurring in anything. It comes from the sun. So it's fortified, just exactly. like it's fortified in a cereal. So that's not natural in there.
Exactly.
But with that, with those elements that you're desiring, someone's desiring some protein or some calcium, which you can get in plant sources and more bioavailable, by the way, you're also getting saturated fat, some trans fats, cholesterol,
hormones,
sugars,
antibiotics,
cruelty. Let's not forget that.
There you go. It is, the list is kind of endless. And so it's just weighing out, okay, can I get something that's also going to provide all these wonderful, valuable nutrients that I need, macro and micro, without all the yuck? That's what that's the part we don't learn and the part that we need to be educating ourselves on, I think. And that's what you do a great job at.
I think so too. I mean, we've just been taught that milk is just this, you know, neutral kind of harmless fluid and helpful fluid that we need throughout our lives. And it is actually a nursing secretion. Like, it is for babies. And you have no more reason as a human to drink the nursing secretions of a cow than you do from a dog or from a giraffe or from a rat.
I mean, or from your own mother.
As an adult.
That'd be weird.
I mean, look how ridiculous it would be. Just gross, the sound of that, right? To still be nursing from your mother at your age, but that's what you're doing.
Yeah.
And so it's this is marketing. This is the power of marketing that has made you think that you need to have nursing secretions in a carton that is chilled, that you pour into a glass, that you drink or pour into coffee, right? That is filled with all of these harmful ingredients. It contains antibiotics that are fed to the cows. It contains pus, mucus, it contains blood. I mean, the USDA, the FDA allows a certain amount of that because it's coming from a cow that's sick and has a masticated udder. So, you can't avoid the blood and the pus and the mucus that's getting in there. And it should gross you out. You can't see it, but it's there. And then you're getting the saturated fat, you're getting the animal protein, all of that is unhealthy and coursing through your bloodstream. And and it's also in other dairy products. So a lot of times nutritionists will say to eliminate the dairy products first because people think they are actually more healthful than meat. Mm-hmm. They might be able to get rid of other types of meat and still eat fish perhaps. But the dairy products, they seem to think are not as harmful, and they can actually be more harmful because in terms of milk, it's in so many things. So yes, you absolutely have to shift your mind when it comes to milk, just like sugar. It's a mental shift. It tastes good, you're used to it, but your palate will change. And once you wean yourself off of it, and wean is the correct term, once you wean yourself off of this nursing secretion as a grown man, it will, if you eat it again or you drink it again after 21 days, it's going to taste gross to you. So it's all doable. It's a mental shift. It's completely unhealthy and unnecessary, and it's just marketing. We think we're too smart to be duped by marketing, but that's all it is. That's the reason that we drink it.
Yeah, I think the biggest fear that I have is the dementia side of it, and or Alzheimer's. The fact that one of the doctors that we had on in a previous show was talking about the consumption of milk will cause, by the time I'm 60, 65 years old, I'm 42, will cause me to possibly be at risk for those, horrible diseases that nobody wants.
Yeah, dairy, absolutely. That's true. And processed meat as well. Yeah, it's true.
And this is good for our audience too. Give up dairy first. Most people give up meat first, but giving up dairy first, Michael, and then finding those substitutes instead of buying the meat. It takes as much time to go to the place where they have the, and I know that in Ralph's and Vons and Safeway, they have them, especially here in California, the sausages and the other alternative meats that are plant-based. So we look forward to hearing, Michael, how your next dinner is.
I know, Tracye, for me, ever since we started talking at the beginning, you're talking about your sister and mom, and you guys have been doing this for a long time, and I felt like I wish there was like a sign-up sheet to come to your next holiday dinner, because I know it's probably going to be amazing. But what's going to be on the table?
We're talking about that now, in fact.
Okay, because Thanksgiving soon.
Thanksgiving coming up. So we're going to have some recipes, and this is just coincidence, but we are going to have some recipes from the new book, Ageless Vegan. So the first thing is the perfect pecan pie. That's a must.
Yum.
We're making a couple of those. It's our favorite recipe in the book, a dessert, but it's delicious. Mm. No dairy, no milk or eggs. And my mother tweaked that from a recipe that her mother made when she was growing up in Camden, South Carolina. And she made it vegan. So there's that. And usually it depends on how we're feeling, whether we're busy at the time. We might go to a restaurant and get, like the mac and cheese. We might get some oven fried tofu. I might make a quiche, or I might make lasagna. We don't stick to, it has to look like turkey, or it has, we don't do that anymore. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if I'm the best example of that, but, the whole holiday itself is loaded. So
I would love to see a tofu shaped turkey. That would be amazing.
People make them.
There's tofurkey, but I don't like it. I used to eat it back in the day, but I don't like it. My mother makes these wonderful tofu cutlets. So we have a recipe in the book, but it's just basically like oven baked, crispy on the outside, lots of seasoning. Sometimes she'll make some sage gravy and pour it over the tofu cutlets. Or sometimes, you know, we don't do tofu at all. We might, you know, again, I might make a veggie lasagna. What else do we do? Sometimes we just do a stir fry with almonds and string beans and shiitake mushrooms and hot pepper. So it's whatever we feel like and whoever feels like cooking. And you
what
know,
about a stuffing?
What, come up with.
What about a stuffing? Like a
My mother actually makes a delicious stuffing. And she'll make that sometimes, but you know, she's 82, she does what she wants. So
whatever she feels.
She makes it great. If she doesn't, hey. We make a vegan mac and cheese, definitely. And that's the recipe. This is a long-standing recipe that we have, but I make at least one or two pans of that and bring that. And then I also love coconut curry, like Thai coconut curry. So sometimes I'll make a Thai coconut curry stew with chickpeas or soup. So it's, you know, it's not necessarily a traditional meal, you know, in terms of Thanksgiving, but it's just an opportunity to like feast. Yeah. On whatever vegan food we eat.
I'm still going to apply to be there. Yeah. No, me too.
Sounds so good. I'm hungry.
You and your books are certainly emblematic of how wide a variety of foods are available for vegans. And so, yeah, thank you for that. Ageless Vegan and By Any Greens Necessary.
And where do people get the vegan starter kit? Because you didn't say that. Where can they get it?
Oh, yeah. AfricanAmericanVeganStarterGuide.com.
And they just order it and it'll just show up at their house.
It'll just order it. You can order a printed copy up to 500. It'll just show up at your house, free postage, or you can download the free PDF. 40
Brilliant. Pages. And that'll be in the show notes too.
Great. Okay. Thank you so much for everything. Yeah. We really appreciate you being on the show.
Out?
Yeah. Oh, I told you it's crazy how fast it goes.
Oh my goodness.
We'll have you on again.
I enjoyed it.
Yeah. Thank you. You've been terrific. And thank you so much. Michael?
No, thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you. I look forward to the report.
That's right. Thank you so much, Tracy. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.
So thank you so much for tuning in today. If we helped you in any way, then click the subscribe button and let's keep hanging out together. We have so much more to share with you.
And if you need more information on actually making the switch for good, please visit us at switchforgood.org for loads of info. And you can subscribe to our mailing list where you will receive all sorts of super cool gifts, discount codes to our very fave dairy-free products, and a lifetime of powerful health tips.
So join us on the journey to switch for good. This is the future.